Welcome, everybody, at Harvest Fellowship, either in person or by the live stream. It's wonderful to have you with us this evening as we prepare to sing some words of worship to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Before we do that, let's go ahead and say a word of prayer, and then we will get started here. Heavenly gracious Father, we thank you and we praise you for granting us yet another opportunity to come to this place to worship you and to grow in you, Lord. I think all of us have heard about the recent tragedies and atrocities that have happened across our nation, Lord. It is such a terrible thing, Lord. Lord, we thank you, and may you help us never to take for granted the gift of life itself, Lord, because it is it's amazing how quickly it can be taken away, and in the most unforeseen circumstances, Lord. Lord, we pray that you be a God of comfort in this time, Lord. You've not given us a spirit of fear, Lord. Lord, please remind us and remind all of your followers of that, Lord. May you work out everything for the good of those who love you, Lord. In your gracious name, we humbly pray and we praise you. Amen. All right. Here we go. He has made me glad. I will answer his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad.
Something glory.
merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way.
Lord, as we sing that song, we want to do that now. Whatever we're struggling with, whatever anxiety, worry, frustration, problem has just got us focused on that instead of you. May we truly give these things over to you. We cast all of our cares upon you. And may you just open our eyes and ears to see wondrous things from your law. Let us not be distracted by this world right now, but just to hear from you and to listen and obey. In your name, amen. All right, you may be seated. 1 Samuel 17. 1 Samuel 17. We're going to finish up 1 Samuel 17. It's quite the chapter there, David and Goliath. And we've been going at a pretty good pace here through the book of 1 Samuel. Been averaging about two chapters a week. We're going to slow it down here, though, for this one, because I want to make sure that we cover this. Tonight's lesson is David and Goliath. And tonight's lesson has nothing deep theologically in it that's going to make you sit there and scratch your head. It's a classic Sunday school lesson, David and Goliath. And I do not say that as demeaning in any way whatsoever. It is a go-to story for children, the visuals, the giant, the small shepherd boy that becomes the hero, God's power on display. I have this memory of dressing the boys up in armor and recreating David and Goliath at home. It is this boy's favorite story. You have war, you have giants, and you have heads being chopped off. I mean, it's just everything any little boy could ever want. Most of the teachings I've heard on this, and I include myself as well, have a tendency to focus on the David and Goliath aspects. This idea that you have a giant in your life that is intimidating you. It's breathing threats against you, but yet in the power of God, you can overcome it. You have a giant at work. There's a problem with no visible solution, but God can give you the strength. You have a giant of a problem in your marriage, in your home, but God can get you through it. You have a giant addiction, a giant sin that you need to knock that sin down and chop off its head. We are David fighting giants in our lives. And those are really, honestly, great teaching points. They really are. And a pastor likes a simple point like that. It resonates. It's memorable. It excites. It encourages. But the question that comes up is it the proper context? And the reality is, not exactly. Is it unbiblical? No, it's not unbiblical to say that you're a David fighting a giant. But let's not jump to that first. Original purpose to the original audience. Keep that in the back of your mind. Original purpose to the original audience. Now, let me build on this for a while, and just bear with me, please. There's a saying that I like a lot. It says, the text of Scripture is not neutral. The text of Scripture is not neutral. It has a purpose, it has an audience, it has a reason why it was written. Think about a vehicle in neutral. A neutral vehicle can be pushed around to wherever you want it to go. You can push it to a destination. A neutral Bible can be pushed to wherever you want it to go, and this has been twisted over the years. You want polygamy with multiple wives? Let me push the Bible there and you can find verses that back it up. You want free sexual morality in any way you want? Let me push that passage over there and you can have it. You want the idea of universalism? Everybody is saved. There is no hell. Well, let me nudge the verse that way. I have seen people put verses in neutral and they use the Bible for defense of so many sins. It is sad how people have quoted the Bible at me to defend sin in their life. Simply put, we don't get to put our meaning into the text. We read the text, we take it at its original purpose and its original setting and its original audience and meaning, and then we apply it. If you don't do that, we can read an obscure Old Testament passage and we can make it be whatever we want. People send me messages on a regular basis they want me to listen to. And there's a danger when a teacher takes some Old Testament passage or some New Testament passage and builds a whole message off that one verse. I have heard some awful, awful teachings that sound very eloquent, they're very articulate, and they're very passionate, and they're completely, utterly out of context. I got a message sent to me years ago where the man took a verse out of the book of Isaiah, and as I'm listening to him teach, I'm thinking, that's not what that verse is saying in any way whatsoever, and he built this whole message off of it, and it was completely, completely wrong. It was so wrong, I went back and re-listened to it a second time to say, okay, I want to make sure I'm hearing this right. But it was biblical, right? He had a verse. He ran with it. He made the point that he wanted to make. And I tell you, it was a fun message. If you'd like that dogma, you will go with it and you will run with it. But there's a danger in taking a passage that was written with an original purpose than making us in the 21st century fit it in. Now, two verses, and I'm going to give you some examples of this. I firmly believe 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to every good work. I firmly believe that. Every verse is important. It is very easy to start looking at a book like Romans and elevating Romans over Obadiah. We cannot do that. Both of them are the inspired word of God. It's easy to take John 3:16 and say that verse is more important than some obscure verse in the book of Esther. They're all inspired by the word of God. So all scripture is inspired by God. And I do believe that the Old Testament people are given to us as an example. 1 Corinthians 10 tells us this. Now these things became our examples. I am supposed to learn from David. I am supposed to learn from Goliath. But I have to see the context of it. I want to show you this point. Go with me to the book of Jeremiah, please. Jeremiah 29. If you're in a really good spot spiritually, a really good spot, and you're concerned that the spot you're in is too good, read the book of Jeremiah. It will bring you down in a heartbeat. Jeremiah is a depressing, discouraging book. It's about a man that is giving his heart over to the people that is constantly rejected in all ways, and he has a message that is hated, but it's a message that he must present. But we love Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. As the New Living Translation says, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good, not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. That is a graduation card verse right there. That is a mirror verse. That is a verse of the day on a calendar. That should be at the bottom of every Christian card that is ever written. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. We love that verse. Stay in Jeremiah. And now go to Jeremiah 44, please. Keep your hand there in Jeremiah 29:11. Now go to Jeremiah 44. We love Jeremiah 29:11. We claim Jeremiah 29:11. We want to live Jeremiah 29:11. Jeremiah 44, verse 11. Therefore says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will set my face against you for catastrophe and for cutting off all Judah. Or as it says in the New Living Translation, therefore this is what the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of Israel, says, I am determined to destroy every one of you. I think you should put that at the bottom of your graduation cards. I am determined to destroy every one of you. Very simple point, and I will explain this. Why do we get to claim Jeremiah 29:11, but we don't claim Jeremiah 44:11? Same book, same author, same Holy Spirit, but yet we claim Jeremiah 29:11 for us, that God has a wonderful plan for my life. But I would never claim Jeremiah 44:11, where it says, I am determined to destroy every one of you. Why? Context. He's talking to the same group of people through the same prophet, same Holy Spirit. He's talking to Israel that's gone backsliding. But yet what happens is we come in and we stop and say, oh, I like that verse. I'm taking that verse for me. But yet we don't want to take Jeremiah 44:11. Let me give you one more example of this. Can you go with me to Philippians 4:13? Philippians 4:13. We'll bring the wagons back to Jeremiah 20:11, don't worry. Philippians 4:13. This is another famous verse. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's a great verse. Somebody's battling sickness, you send them that verse. Somebody's going through a difficult time. They have a bad day at work. Your kid's getting ready to go to school. They're nervous. They're worked up. They're upset. They don't know how they're going to do in that test, that exam. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I heard a testimony one time of a person that was at the foul line trying to win the game with a free throw, and that verse came to their mind, and they quoted that verse, that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I always wondered, what happens if the defense is quoting that same verse, saying, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me? This is a go-to verse to say whatever trouble you are facing, God will give you the strength to get through it. Context. Back up, please. Verse 11. Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere in all things I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The context of that verse is, Paul says, I can be hungry, and I can be full, and I'm still content. I can have success, and I can have failure, and I'm still content, because I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So the true context of verse 13 is, when your kid is getting ready to go take that a biology exam, and they're worked up, and you say, hey, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. What you're really saying in the context is, if you come back with an F, God is still just as good. If you come back with a failing grade, you can learn to handle that, because you know how to abound, and you know how to be abased. From a teaching standpoint, I can have a message that really clicks, and everybody loves it. So I can bound, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, and that won't go to my head. I can have a message that completely falls flat, and there's no fruit, if any, at all. And I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, because now I've been brought low and abased, because I'm content in him. That's the context that passes. So if you quote that verse for the free throw, you make it, it doesn't go to your head, because you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you, because you're content. You miss it, it doesn't bother you, because you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You know how to abound and you know how to be abased. That's the context of it. But when we quote just that one verse, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, which may mean failing. That's okay. Back to Jeremiah 29:11. You don't need to turn there. Does God have a plan for your life? You bet he has a plan for your life. Are they good and not for disaster to give you a future and a hope? If you're born again and saved, you bet it's good. Welcome to eternity. What happens if cancer is what gets you there? Plan's still good. The context of Jeremiah 29:11, he is talking to people that are not... The context of Jeremiah 29:11 is, here's this nation that is in utter rebellion. And God is telling them, I have a plan for this. Yes, this looks like a failure. Yes, this looks like a complete mess, but I have a plan for what I'm going to do, and you have to trust me. Is it wrong for us then to go quote Jeremiah 29:11 to people? It's not necessarily wrong, because the reality is, the truth is, God's nature and character is he does have a plan for us, and he is good and he does good. The problem with taking that verse, even though we're talking about the nature and character of the Lord, that verse specifically is not going to be applicable to us in that sense of that was written to them. The context of it is that, but the character of God is still able to be addressed in it. So can you send that verse at the bottom of your graduation cards? That's between you and the Lord. I've known for me that I kind of hesitate to send that verse to as many people as I used to. Because when I start thinking about it is, you know, if they ever would go look that verse up, they could walk away saying, so James thinks I'm a Jew that's about to get attacked by Babylon, and my family's going to be destroyed, but God says, I have a plan for you. That's the context of that passage. Now, it's really easy to focus on a verse. And I know I've shared this with you before, so just bear with me. It was about in 1200, 1300, we got verses. Excuse me, we got chapters in 1200, 1300. About 1500, we got verses. So we've only had verses for about 500 years. Before that, they just had these big sections. And verses are great. So tonight, I said we're going to go to 1 Samuel 17, verse 12. You immediately can go to 1 Samuel 17, verse 12. Now, if we did not have verses and chapters, and you had scrolls, I would say we're going to be in the history book scrolls. So you'd go find your scroll. And we're going to be in 1 Samuel. And we're going to be about halfway through the third scroll. Verses are great. The problem with verses is this. People find a verse. Just a verse. And they build doctrine off that verse. What about the verses before it? What about the verses after it? Sometimes what about the chapters before it and the chapters after it? That's what I want to show you here tonight with David and Goliath. Yes, it is really easy just to jump to this point of you are David, this shepherd boy, taking on giants in your life, and God will empower you to do it. That is true. But the primary interpretation and context of this passage has nothing to do with that. When this book was written, if you were a Jew at that time and you got your hands on a scroll, let's say you were a Levite and you were serving at the tabernacle or temple and you had free time and you wanted to go look through the scrolls and you read this story, I do not think that you would sit back and just scratch your head and go, wow, I'm David, taking on Goliath. No, you would stop and say, oh, the main point is what? Well, back in 1 Samuel 8, verse 20, Israel said, we want a king that will fight our battles for us. And then Saul comes around in verse 11. When Saul and all Israel heard the words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. The main context is Saul completely, utterly failed as being a king. The whole purpose of him being a king was to lead his troops in battle and represent God and be the victor through God's power, and he completely failed in that. And David is the one that got the victory through the Lord. That's the main context of this chapter. Secondary point, God has empowered David to lead. God is the one that has empowered David to lead. If you go back to 1 Samuel 13, verse 14, you don't need to turn there. God says, I'm going to raise up a man after my own heart. That's David. David will lead in the power of the Lord. He'll care about the things of God. Look at David's response here in verse 26. David spoke to the men who stood by him, saying, what shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? That's David's heart. That you're defying the armies of the living God. Verse 36, same chapter, David. Your servant has killed both lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God. The secondary context is David is empowered by the Lord with a heart for God. He wants to see God glorified. He wants to see God get the glory and God get the victory. And how dare anybody speak against his God? We're not even to Goliath yet. He's a secondary character. He's not even in the top two, I should say. It's really David and Saul. Saul failing as a king, David being empowered by the Lord. And you see how David did not take the kingdom from Saul, but was ordained by God and empowered by God. If you get through those first main points, then we can talk about being a David taking on Goliath. Now, to be completely honest with you, what's more exciting? What's going to get people to come to church? What's going to get people to watch the message and share it online? That you are a David fighting Goliath, you can have a lot of fun message titles like that. Taking down your Goliath. What's the real message? Saul's failures as a king based on man's expectations of what a king should be. No one's going to click on that. Not in any way whatsoever. But this is where context is so vitally important. It's not necessarily wrong to jump to that point of, wow, David defeated Goliath. If he empowered David, he's going to empower me. Well, amen. That's a biblical concept. But the real context is Saul failed as a king. David was empowered to lead as the next king. Like I said, Goliath is near the bottom of what's really going on here. Let's pause real quick. Any quick questions, comments about any of this? Because I want to make sure we're all on the same page before we even get to this. Knowing how to read and study the Bible, especially Old Testament. Just be careful. What I am noticing more and more is there are some really funky teachings going on out there that once again are picking just obscure verses or picking just single verses. And next thing you know, they're doing whole doctrine on it. Got to be careful about that stuff. Okay, so when looking at this, it's easy to see a consistent comparison between Israel's first king and Saul and God's choice of David. That's the main idea here. It comes across as Saul was the king that man would want. Remember, he's described as a man mighty of power. He's handsome, he's tall, he's big. What nation would not want that man as a king? It's every nation's dream. And remember what we said, we want a man, a king that's going to go judge us and go out before us and fight our battles, 1 Samuel 8:20. They got the king, but Saul did not judge them godly, and Saul did not go fight their battles. When given an opportunity to lead them in battle, what did he do? He looked around for someone else to go do it. And not even look around for someone else to go do it. We're going to get to this in a little bit. He promised rewards to those who would go do it. He was so scared to go do it. He says, I will pay somebody to go do this. Please remember, Saul is head and shoulders above everybody else in Israel. The Bible makes that clear. So here comes Goliath, who's 9 foot something tall. Says, send out your best guy. Is not everybody going to look at Saul? The biggest, strongest, most powerful? And there's Saul scared to death. This is the king they wanted, and this is the king they got. When given that opportunity to show his might and leadership in battle, he went nowhere near Goliath. That's the utter failure that's going on right here. But their true king, David, fully realized who was going to win this battle. And David went in to do the fighting. Now, they also wanted a king that would judge them in godly ways. What was Saul's judgment like? I won't go through all the details. We covered this in the last couple weeks. 1 Samuel 13, he acted foolishly. 1 Samuel 13, he gave in to fear and made a decision because he was compelled to by them, pushed into it. He spoke rashly. He's a scoffer. We went through all this the last couple weeks ago. He was not obedient in any way whatsoever. Very simply put, Saul did not meet the requirements in any way whatsoever. What's the answer to this? The answer is David. David is really the antithesis of Saul's leadership. He is the one that it should be. David would judge in a godly manner. Saul did not. Now, please realize, David's not perfect. I'm not going to defend David in any way whatsoever. But David had a heart for the Lord. He wanted to see the ark come to Jerusalem. He wanted to see the temple built. And he has a heart for the Lord in this. That's the main context. Last point, then, before we get into the actual verses here. We live in a society today that likes everything quick, fast, and easy. We just do. I was at Walmart today picking some stuff up, and there's more self-checkouts than there are people with the actual register, because we got to move quickly. We have to have double drive-through lanes at the fast food. We have to sit in front of the microwave and tapping our fingers waiting for the microwave popcorn to get done, because 1:50 is way too long. We got to move quicker. So what happens now in this society that has to move quickly? Somebody wants something really deep. Pick any deep topic you want in the Bible, predestination. Hey, what's predestination? Hey, I got a great book on it if you're willing to read it. Yeah, I mean, like in one sentence. I can't. There's a pastor I know and respect a lot, and he says he will not debate anybody. He will not get into any discussions online where it involves any type of Twitter if you only can do a sentence or two. He goes, you can't take the deep things of God and try to explain it in a sentence or two. You know, Paul wrote the book of Romans to try to explain sin and righteousness. And here we are now in the 21st century saying, well, let me just in one sentence explain it. No way. So the little tweets and memes and catchy slogans, no. We don't want to read multiple volumes of books explaining a subject that takes too long. Give me the condensed version. But I love this quote. If we feed ourselves only on proof texts, role models and types and, quote, thoughts for the day, we restrict our ability to know God. If you just want that quick, fast, easy, there will not be any depth. And to truly understand it, it's going to take a lot of time to dig in and understand. I'm doing a study through an Old Testament book right now that the first time I went through it, I got nothing. I mean, it's a hard book for me to figure out what the plan is and the plot and the pattern and everything. So I went through it again about 1.5 years ago, and finally some of the light came on. I'm going through it again now, and finally it's starting to make sense. But it has taken a long time, a lot of reading. But it's like I told Dawn today, I said, this is amazing. It's an amazing book. I said, you need to study it. You need to read it. You need to see this. She said, yeah, thanks, no. But, you know, what are you supposed to do with somebody who's immature in the Lord? I mean, what are you supposed to do with that? I mean, to put the time, energy, and effort into it, it takes a lot of work. It does. I don't say that to elevate. I just say that's the reality. Because it's really easy to read through 1 Samuel 17 and say, oh, cool, David beat Goliath. Yeah, but there's so many levels to that. So with all that being said, verse 12. This is why we're only doing one chapter tonight. Now, David was the son of the Ephrite of Bethlehem, Judah, whose name was Jesse and who had 8 sons, and the man was old, advanced in years in the days of Saul. 3 older sons of Jesse had gone to follow Saul to the battle. The names of his 3 sons who went to the battle were Eliab, firstborn, next to him is Abinadab, and the 3rd Shammah. And David was the youngest, and the 3 oldest followed Saul. But David occasionally went and returned from Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem. Let's start with 15 first. Please remember, at the end of chapter 16, David had a music ministry with Saul to help him. This is showing us that David kind of comes and goes with that as Saul needed. Now, if you're reading through 12 through 14, here's context again. Why all this detail? Why? Why are we repeating verse 12, what we already just told us earlier, who Jesse was? We've already been explained to who Jesse was. Back in 16, explains this, because this is an important detail. And the writer of Samuel is saying, listen, I need to reintroduce the lineage and the details. You need to know who David is. The most talked about character in the Old Testament. You've got to know who he is. Now, we're reading this from understanding David, but the original audience at this time just met David last chapter. They're being told again, remember, his dad is Jesse. He's from Bethlehem. He's of the tribe of Judah. And remember, verse 13, he has brothers. Why is it telling us this detail about his oldest brother, Eliab? Because he's going to become important in a little bit. Why is it making sure that we know that he's the firstborn? Verse 13, God wastes no details. If he wants us to know he's the firstborn, because that detail is going to become important in a little bit. So verse 14, why is it telling us that David was the youngest? Because that detail is going to become important in a little bit. These are all important things that it's easy just to read over, but if we stop and say, what's the context of this? There's a reason why God is telling me this. Verse 16. And the Philistine drew near and presented himself 40 days, morning and evening. Then Jesse said to his son David, take now for your brothers an ephah of this dried grain and these 10 loaves and run to your brothers at the camp and carry these 10 cheeses to the captains of their thousand and see how your brothers fare and bring back news of them. Now Saul and all the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines. So David rose early in the morning, left the sheep with the keeper and took the things and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the camp and the army was going out to fight and shouting for the battle. For Israel and the Philistines had drawn up in battle array, army against army. And David left his supplies in the hands of the supply keeper, ran to the army, and came and greeted his brothers. Please remember, when you see the word 40 in the Bible, verse 16, there's enough times of 40 in the Bible that you realize this is some type of trial. You know, it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. You have the idea of Jesus being tempted for 40 days, 40 nights. There's this idea of 40. So that idea of 40 days, verse 16, is supposed to symbolically show us this is a trial. For 40 days, this beast of a man came out, looked at Israel and said, let's fight. And for 40 days, Israel cowered in fear. Verse 11 again, Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine. They were dismayed and greatly afraid. 40 days of intimidation, 40 days of fear, 40 days of being scared. We talked about this last week, verse 19. The way this is set up is they had two mountains with a valley in between. One army's on one mountain, one army's on the other mountain, and they wanted to meet in the middle. What they really wanted is the other army to come up the mountain. You have a better defensive position. So if you go down to the valley, you're on equal terms. Israel's hoping, no, we don't really want to fight this battle. But they're both waiting for the first person to make the first move. Verse 23. Then as he talked with them, therefore was the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, coming up from the armies of the Philistines. And he spoke according to the same words, so David heard them. Please note in 23, coming up. Kind of carries the idea that Goliath is kind of moving a little closer to these Israelites. Like, come on, let's do this. This giant of a man is becoming even bigger. You know, from a few hundred feet away, 9 foot tall is still pretty big. But all of a sudden, if he starts coming near the base of the mountain and is willing to come up a little bit, there's a lot of fear going on. 24, and all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him and were dreadfully afraid. Note the repetition there. Dreadfully afraid, emphasized in 24 and verse 11. So the men of Israel said, have you seen the man who's come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel. Now it should be that the man who kills him, the king will enrich with great riches and give him his daughter and give his father's house exemption from taxes in Israel. Then David spoke to the men and stood by him saying, what shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? And the people answered him in this manner saying, shall it be done for the man who kills him? Please note in verse 26, by David asking, it's not David trying to see what he would get. This is almost a pep talk. He's saying, come on, guys. Look how David describes him, verse 26. The uncircumcised Philistine. That means spiritually. This guy is not part of the covenant, guys. He's not a Jew. He's not an Israelite. He's against God. We're supposed to fight him. We're supposed to defeat him. He is defying the armies of the living God. David is seeing this from a spiritual standpoint. Why do you have 25 and 26 back to back like this? Because you're supposed to note the contrast between David and the men of Israel. I heard one teaching get into this great detail about this. They call Goliath the man. David calls him the uncircumcised Philistine. See, the guys in Israel in verse 25 see the man. Oh, that guy's big. I don't know why it is, and I do this, and I notice my boys doing this. We're watching a game at home, and there's this really big guy. First thing we say, I wonder how tall he is. Maybe it's because I don't have that height. I'm always impressed. Like, how tall are you? You know what I mean? So Israel's like, the man. David's like, no, he's an uncircumcised Philistine. What do they do in 25? They came out to defy Israel. David says, no, they're not defying Israel. They're defying the armies of the living God. Guys in verse 25 are like, look at everything you get if you kill him. David in 26 says, the man who kills this Philistine removes the disgrace from Israel. The commentator said this, in short, the men of Israel see a fearsome giant who's reproaching Israel. David sees merely an uncircumcised Philistine who is defying the living God. That is a huge difference right there. David's not intimidated. This guy is defying God. 28. Now Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he had spoke to these men, and Eliab's anger was aroused against David. He said, why did you come down here? With whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart, for you have come down to see the battle. And David said, what have I done now? Is there not a cause? Then he turned from him toward another and said the same thing, and these people answered him as the first one did. Now, when the words which David had spoke were heard, they reported them to Saul, and he sent for him. Then David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight against this Philistine. Remember all that emphasis on David's brothers, and he's the youngest, and Eliab is the oldest? Verse 28 is repeated again. Now, let's just pause real quick here. Why the detail with that? Why is Eliab upset? His anger was aroused. He's jealous. He's worked up. He says, David, you're just prideful. Now think about this for a second. If you go back to 1 Samuel 16, what happened? Samuel showed up at Jesse's house and said, bring your boys to me. Who was the first boy they brought? Eliab. And the description of Eliab was what? Look at his appearance. Surely, verse 6 of 1 Samuel 16, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. And Eliab was what? Passed by. Who was picked? David. David, who was so forgotten about that when Samuel says, invite your boys, he didn't get the invitation. Do you not think that the oldest kind of looks at the youngest and says, you're the next king? That should have been me. You're going to be the one God anointed. Samuel the prophet came to see you, anointed you. He had to do this in front of me. I'm the one that got turned down. Oh, how much does the oldest not like when the youngest gets something before them? So there's built up jealousy here. There's built up anger. There's built up pride. And it's all coming out now. But look at David in verse 32. Let no man's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine. Please note, David's not talking about fighting the giant. This is just a Philistine. This is just a guy that needs to be defeated, and somebody needs to step up and do this. And if no one is going to do it, I'll do it. 33, and Saul said to David, you're not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you're a youth, and he's a man of war from his youth. David, you're a youth, and from his youth, Goliath has been battling. He's a man of war. 34, David said to Saul, your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck and killed it. Your servant has killed both lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God. Moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine. And Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you. Please note once again, David emphasized uncircumcised Philistine. He sees this as a spiritual battle. And please note once again, David emphasizes in verse 36, he has defied the armies of the living God. This has nothing to do with Israel in David's mind. This is God has been defamed. And this man needs to be destroyed. Please remember, the main context, Saul is not battling. The king that they wanted to go lead them in battle is not doing it. Look at the detail in 34 through 36. Reminds me of the verse in Luke 16. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. He who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Be faithful in the little things, and God will give you the bigger things. David says, I've shown this. Lions, bears, oh my, nothing to worry about. The Lord took care of that. He'll take care of me here. I look at this when it comes to service. I remember out here at church, some of the first things that I did, 93 is when I got saved, so nearly 30 years ago. Setting up tables and chairs. I remember Jim sending me home with cassette copies and making cassette copies because we had the tape of the month. Running sound, working in nursery, worship team, Sunday school, doing announcements, all these things. And then I would hope that over time that it was proven that hopefully I was a faithful servant of the Lord. There's a lot of people, though, that want to jump right to the giants, and they do not want to take care of lions and bears first. I received a phone call years ago from a man that I met one time. He came out to church one time. And I could tell he was an interesting character. And lots of questions, lots of comments, lots of words. So I said, let's meet for lunch. So we met. And it was a crazy conversation. If you've ever been in any type of ministry, you run into that personality that that person is so all over the place that you stop and you say, Lord, this is going to take an act of God to get this person focused where they need to be. Never saw him, never heard from him again. Never. So one time at church, one meal out together, and disappeared. Years, literally years later, he calls me up. Took me a while to remember who he was. He said, hey, just got into an argument at the church I'm going to now. Big argument. I'm never going back there again. And I want to start coming back out to your church. Now, at that point, red flags. I'm thinking, nope, you don't want to come out to my church. If you ever think a pastor only wants the seats filled, then you don't understand. Sometimes there's blessed subtractions, where it's, I hope the Lord leads you some other place. So, you're not called to come out here. I can tell this is not going to go good. But I thought, I can't say that, so I thought I need to be biblical. What's the biblical thing? Before you try to come out here and plant yourself here, I said you need to make peace with the people that you have an issue with. That's biblical. You can't just run from a problem, run from a fight. So you got to go make biblical peace with them. And I said, and if that happens, we'd love to see if the Lord's calling you out here. Okay, fine. Calls back that evening. Goes, hey, the Lord laid it on my heart. I'm not making this up. Saturday evening. Calls back, says, he wants me to teach tomorrow at your church. No, he doesn't. Yeah, he does. Pretty sure he doesn't. Yeah, he does. Now, that's a guy that wants to jump right at the giant. He doesn't want to deal with lions. He doesn't want to deal with bears. He just wants to go right for the giant. I've had that happen over the years out here before. I remember one time there was a guy that came to my office and said, I feel led to get into the ministry. I said, amen. I said, we have a spot open in the back to start practicing teaching with the kids, because I remember what I was always told, and I don't know if it's a Calvary Chapel thing or not, but if you can't present the gospel to kids, how you be able to present it to adults? So can you go show love to the sheep, to the lambs? He goes, yeah, I'm not going to do that. He goes, I just want to teach on a Sunday morning. I think your heart's being shown here a little bit. I get what you're saying, and maybe you're not called to children's ministry full-time. I get that. But we need to be able to prove ourselves faithful in the little things, and I'm not calling being in the back little. Please don't take it that way. But let's look at the spiritual responsibility here. David comes and says, listen, if God has empowered me to take out a bear, and God has empowered me to take out a lion, God's going to empower me to take out this man. Not a giant, but just this man. Please note the difference between David and Saul in verse 37. David acknowledges the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine. Saul would never have said anything like that, because Saul was all about him. 38, so Saul clothed David with his armor, and he put on a bronze helmet on his head, and he also clothed him with a coat of mail. David fastened his sword to his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them. And David said to Saul, I cannot walk with these, for I have not tested them. So David took them off. I mean, the reality is David has not been trained in armor. He's not going to be able to do this. And Saul clothed David with his armor, verse 38. Saul is head and shoulders above everybody else. This is like me giving my suit coat to my youngest. It's not going to work in any way whatsoever. Now, I do want to pause here real quick, because I do want to make this point. Maybe a little bit of a pep talk here. I do want to keep in the context of the passage, but you have to be you and I have to be me. Now, this is not some little feel-good pep talk. This is the reality. I can learn from others, I can be influenced by others, but I got to wear the armor that I'm supposed to wear. And if I try to wear the armor that somebody else wears, it's not going to fit for me. I just have to be me. I received some great advice years ago that told me, be passionate about things, but don't be pushy about it. My armor works for me. I don't know what armor works for you. Just make sure that your armor is biblical. So if you come to me and say, well, James, I'm going to do this, I can say, amen. If it's in the Lord, of the Lord, for the Lord, His glory, then you go do it. But if it's unbiblical, I have to stop and say, that's not of the Lord. So don't think that you have to copy yourself off to somebody else. You just got to be who the person the Lord has called you to be and wear the armor that God has called you to do it. 40, then he took his staff in his hand and he chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in a shepherd's bag and a pouch which he had, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. Now, at the beginning of the chapter, we had all this great description on Goliath's armor, you know, hundreds of pounds worth of armor and shield. He's a walking tank. And David has a staff and a few stones. So the Philistine came and began drawing near to David, and the man who bore the shield went before him. So here's a walking tank, but he also has a guy with a shield in front of him. This guy is invincible. David has stones. Now, we know what type of stones these are. These stones are about the size of a billiard ball, a pool ball. So just keep that in mind. And they've done studies on this, and you can get these stones to go up to 60 mile an hour when you throw them. So imagine 60 mile an hour pool ball hitting you in the head. That would probably do a little bit of damage there. 42, and when the Philistine looked about him and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and good looking. I had to see Goliath having scars, probably got a great beard. And there's David, just this kid. So the Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. Please note, this is a spiritual battle. And the Philistine said to David, come to me and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. Then David said to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcass of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know there is a God in Israel. Then all this assembly shall know that the Lord does not save with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. Please note in verses 45 through 47, the word Lord or God is used six times. This is a spiritual battle for David. 48, so it was when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, David hurried and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. David runs to the battle. Doesn't walk. I saw a Hollywood version of this where David had, what, the five stones? And he swings the first one and it bounces off Goliath's armor. He swings the second one and it bounces off his armor. And Goliath is getting closer and David's about to get speared and the last one hits him square between the head. All drama. Nah. Goliath comes near him. David runs towards him. 49, then David put his hand in the bag, took out a stone, and he slung it and struck the Philistine in his forehead. So the stone sunk into his forehead, and he fell on his face to the earth. Remember, just like the Babylonian god Dagon fell face down in front of the ark. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, and he struck the Philistine and killed him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran and stood over the Philistine, took his sword, and drew it out of his sheath, and killed him, and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines saw their champion was dead, they fled. We don't know, and it doesn't matter, if the stone killed Goliath or if the sword killed Goliath. It kind of looks like to me that the stone knocked him down flat unconscious and David finished him off with the sword, but it's not worth debating over. 52, now the men of Israel and Judah rose and shouted and pursued the Philistines as far as the entrance of the valley to the gates of Ekron. And wounded of the Philistines fell along the road to Sharam, and even as far as Gath and Ekron. Gath and Ekron are some of the capitals of the Philistines. Then the children of Israel returned from chasing the Philistines, and they plundered their tents. And David took the head of the Philistine and brought it to Jerusalem, but he put his armor in his tent. 54, that is a 15-mile journey of carrying this head. Just keep that detail in the back of your mind. 55, when Saul saw David going out against the Philistine, he said to Abner, remember, Abner is his uncle, the commander of the army. Abner, whose son is this youth? And Abner said, as your soul lives, O king, I do not know. So the king said, inquire whose son this young man is. Don't get confused by this if you're thinking, well, they've already met last chapter. It looks like what Saul is asking is, give me this guy's lineage. Maybe because part of the promise was, whoever defeats the giant will be able to marry my daughter, if you remember correctly, and also be tax exempt. So let's find out who this guy is. I don't think that Saul is forgetting David. Maybe Saul has forgotten him. Maybe David has king. He's around a lot of people. Maybe he is mentally losing it. I don't know. But I really just think the context is that let's find out who the lineage of this boy is. Then as David returned from the slaughter of the Philistines, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hands. 57, this is a victory trophy. He did what Saul wouldn't do. It's a memorial to God's faithfulness. I'm reading John Bunyan's autobiography right now, and he makes a comment about this passage where he says, if God ever has you cut off the head of a giant, he goes, carry that head with you wherever you go to make sure you remember God's faithfulness. 58, and Saul said to him, whose son are you, young man? So David answered, I am the son of your servant, Jesse the Bethlehemite. Now, I would love to go right into 18 verse 1 because this is where chapter breaks sometimes become an issue because the story just continues perfectly, but time does not permit us to do this. Please remember, original audience, original purpose, original context. Also remember, though, it's not wrong to look at these passages and stop and say, okay, what can I learn from this? They're given to me as examples, but the main context of this David and Goliath is Saul failed as king, and David was empowered by the Lord and saw God's hand and said, I am doing this for the glory of God. The whole idea of the shepherd boy giant is really not the main emphasis. The main emphasis is Saul's failure and David being empowered by God in all ways and all things. And I hope as you read through the Old Testament and you run across some of these passages, and you're like, I don't know what I'm supposed to get from this. Keep in the back of your mind, original audience, original purpose, what's the context? And once you get that down, it will become clearer on what it's trying to say. And if that's something you struggle with, saying, James, I read through some of these books, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, and I got nothing. Let me know. I got some great commentaries I can recommend to you of people that we trust. And it's nice that you can read the Bible, let the Holy Spirit have first dibs here. But then you can come back and say, okay, I'm going to use this teaching to help me have clearer light on this and help kind of explain stuff. Alrighty, any final questions, comments about anything here before we close up? All right, we're good. All right, and way of announcements here real quick. Month of June, hard to believe, coming up. So New Our Daily Bread's back there. Take one for yourself. Take one to hand out to people. Be blessed by that. Which also be blessed by the meal and the time of fellowship with that. Please grab a bulletin. You can see the different things going on, Vacation Bible School, of the work days, the VBS training, volunteers, etc. Small groups throughout here. Lots of things going on. If you weren't with us on Sunday, I encourage you to go back and watch the lesson to see the graduates and get a chance to put a face to the name and pray for them as they're entering a new season of life. And there's lots of graduation parties coming up that the church has been invited to. Check the bulletin board back there as you leave and prayerfully consider going to those and supporting. Let's pray. Lord, as we just come to you now, may we remember the empowering you give, the blessings you give, and may we always put you in the forefront in all ways and all things for our good and your glory. You are good and do good. We love you. We praise you. And Lord, my mind goes right now to also just Donna continuing to recover, just asking for prayer as you strengthen her. You are good and do good. We thank you. We praise you. In your name, amen. You guys have